Don't take on this type of debt in your business. Welcome to the Red to Black podcast, hosted by Warner and Mario. Mario, please expound.
Yeah, so there's recourse lending and there's non-recourse lending. The smart money takes on occasionally when there's something offered that can pay debt back. So there's an asset that is offered at the right price that can pay principal plus interest. There's something called non-recourse lending, and that's actually kind of smart. In certain states, that works well. If you're looking at an asset to purchase that is going to be able to pay back the principal and interest, definitely take on low interest rates or low interest debt when it's non-recourse lending. On the flip side, most people take on recourse debt. They load up on recourse debt, meaning you become a slave to the debtor, or the debtor is the slave to the lender. There we go.
So what are some types of recourse debt? Would you mind giving us some examples?
Yeah, your mortgage. The number one thing that keeps people poor is a mortgage, which rhymes with a morgue, which is like mortuary. So it's death. It's talking about death here. We're talking about where people go to die, and it's where your personal freedom goes to die, is paying a 30-year debt instrument back to a bank on recourse lending, meaning you're responsible for that debt. If that house doesn't pay for itself, which no single family house pays for itself, it's a net loss every month. You're responsible. Your job. They're taxing you to get that money back. So that's a recourse. The bank goes after you, the lender, to get their money back. On the flip side, or 180 degrees from that, 180 from that is non-recourse lending, where you are not responsible for the debt. It's the building, the asset is the collateral, not you, not your labor.
Yeah. So in terms of debt, there's one trend that I see, and there's an individual I was watching on YouTube. I completely forget who it is, and I don't know if I'll remember it. If I do, I'll put it in the comments below. But this individual talked about everything that you do in life requires going into some sort of debt to do it, to create prosperity, right? So look, think about it. I go to college, I take on a student loan. So it's like they've taught us to say, get debt and then I'll be prosperous. I get out of college and then I go take on debt in a mortgage. Again, take on more debt to get prosperity. What Mara and I are talking about in this podcast is no. Don't take on debt to get prosperity. Don't invest in a business that's IPO'd like F45 or Soho House that makes no money. Flip it the other way. Make money first and then buy assets. It's like they've conditioned us to consume, and what we're saying is save and invest and then use cash flows to buy a house when that's like 5% of your cash flows, 10% of your cash flows, or like Mario likes to say, it's a cheeseburger purchase. So it's like 0.001% of your cash flows. So flip it. Don't think I've got to go into debt to create prosperity. Look at it this way. Think about what skill sets that can I create that will pay me without going into debt, and then stack those cash flows, invest in more cash flows, and over the long term, you'll be able to consume whatever you like.
Okay, two points on that, Warner. Number one, no one gets wealthy buying single family houses and living in them. No one. No one in the history of the world ever has gotten wealthy buying a single family house and living in it. It's not how you get wealthy. It's how you become a debtor or a slave to the lender. Number two is look at your debt to net income or your debt to operating income. If you run your life like a business, what you want is a debt to net income of less than 100%. So your total debt, all your debt, your house payment, your credit cards, your truck payment, whatever you got, every last dime of debt, add that up as the numerator divided by the denominator, which is your net income. And that should be no more than 100%. So you, in essence, you could pay off all your debt in 1 year of your labor. 1 year of your labor, you could pay. That's take home pay after 1 year. The total debt should be less than 100% of that. That's a balance sheet that's actually that's a business that's not in too much debt. If you look at the S&P 500, you pull out the best businesses that are drowning in free cash flow, and you look at their debt to net income, it's around 100%. A little bit above, a little bit below. It's right around that number. That's a company that's not on the verge of going bankrupt. You look at the average American, they might be 30 years worth of their labor in debt, 60 years of student loan, cars, credit cards, houses. It's just retarded. It's literally the worst situation you can get yourself in is a bunch of debt. Go the opposite direction, fellas. Stack up a bunch of currency and buy assets that pay you to own them. A single family house, a pickup truck, the crap you buy with your credit card, it doesn't pay you to own it.
Let's look at the numbers real quick. If you make $100,000 per year and your debt is $100,000 per year, does that work? No, but here's why, because it's not your net income. Then take out 30%, $70,000, $100,000. Ooh. Let's bring it down to 70,000. So that could be a pitfall people fall into. Now, throwing the pandemic factor on it as 100% is your starting point, I'd even take that down to 50%. Because what if you lost, if your revenue is just like cut off from here, right? Now you have a margin of safety on that. So using 100% as like your marker, like we talk about when buying 20% operating margin businesses at a minimum, use 20% net income to debt as your base marker, and then go down from there, not up. So if you make, let's say, 100,000 a year, and let's just say you net 100,000 a year, and you go into $1 million house, that's 10 years. Flip it, like I said, flip it the other way. Get 100,000 and then make that 100,000 back in 10 years. Now, I know some people are gonna say, oh, well, I'm going to look for appreciation. And we talked about that in other podcasts. Appreciation doesn't always go up. So it's a fool's game over the long term. So if you're always banking on appreciation to get you out of a situation, at some point, you're going to get burned.
And houses, single family, sorry to jump in here, Warner. Single family houses do not appreciate. They don't appreciate. Adjusted for inflation, they at best keep up with inflation. They do not appreciate. Single family houses are a miserable investment. People need to get over this. The American dream is the American nightmare. That's what the banks created to sell you a mortgage, death, mortality. It's not your friend. Those mortgages for a single family house are not, they're not the American dream. They're the American.
Yeah. And here's the way to tell. If you're triggered by the statement that Mario just said, do the numbers. Okay. I make $100,000 a year net income, and I'm going to go into a $500,000 house. Well, that's basically 5 years to make that back with all your net income. But here's the caveat: you've got to take that all that money to pay that off, and then forego eating, drinking, living, whatever else it is you do. So if you really want to refine it down more, actually do the net income. Not that you make from like your employer or your business, but do the net income after every month when all your expenses are paid off. If you want to get real stringent, do that number that you have that you can deploy that capital at the end of each month, and then look and see what is that compared to the debt I'm taking on. That would be a very, very like conservative way of looking at how much debt you should take on. Now, looking at a business, Mario, real quick, we got about a little minute and a half left. If you could finish it off on this, why are all these businesses that are IPOing, why are they all running on debt like Pinterest?
The IPO is a hustle. They're turning their stock into a currency. They're selling basically worthless stock out in the public market and turn it into cash for their business. It's a way for them to finance basically lose an operation. It's predatory at the basic level that we allow a company to become public that doesn't make money. It's predatory. But it's turned it into the public markets have turned into venture investing. Last point I want to go back to is your $5 latte is not making you poor. A lot of these talking heads on these financial podcasts and television are saying, oh, it's a $3 latte or the $5 latte. If you can skip that, that's not what's making you poor. It's your $500,000 mortgage that's making you poor and keeping you poor. It's not your latte. Enjoy a nice coffee from time to time for $5 at whatever coffee shop you want. That's not what's keeping you poor, folks. It's the mortgage.
Okay, well, thanks, Mario. Yeah, those are great points. Guys, we want to leave you with, don't over indebt yourself to other people. Always stay within your means. Always have the option to be able to pay off your debt at any time.